So now let's turn our attention to how do we accomplish this. This is what we found. I'm going to start off by talking about two anchoring principles. And again, if you're comfortable, feel free to take notes, but we do have a white paper and I love answering email questions, so whatever you're more comfortable with. I just don't like seeing people get all stressed out. No taking. Okay, the two keys, acquisition and automaticity. So let's carefully go over what we mean. Acquisition, learning the new facts in a way that will eventually facilitate retrieval from long-term memory. Okay, so that's your goal there. And I'm gonna break this down, we're gonna give an overview and then we're gonna go down into each step. And then in terms of automaticity, once the child is retrieving the fact from memory, now we gotta get it to that level of automaticity. I think sometimes this is the part where we give up. We have to make sure that those times do get down into that sub-second area, because that's where you're getting the robust, accurate performance and that's sustained over time. Okay, so now we've got acquisition and automaticity. Let's go through them, and we're going to lay out four steps, and then I'm going to show you how our system operationalizes that in a concrete way. So four steps here. The first one, systematic introduction of small sets of new facts. And again, we're trying to do that using the right strategy at the time. Let's go over some of the individual words. Systematic introduction in this case means as best as you can, you need to know the individual learner. To get really good, efficient methods, like all of us here have different states of math fact fluency. It's probably quite high, but you know, the typical kid in your classroom, there's gonna be a lot more variability there. And the same method at that point in time won't make sense for every one of the kids. So as much as possible, you need to know the individual kid and figure out what's the best next thing to teach. Small sets of new facts. Okay, maybe that's been a place where sometimes we've made errors in the past. There are times when you can teach a broader set of facts, like a rule, you know, multiplied by zero or something like that. That gets you a whole bunch of facts in one shot. But we make a lot of usage of fact families. And that's only four facts, right? Something like 3, 4, 12, sort of like chunking, right? You have three numbers there, but you get four facts out of it. 3 times 4, 4 times 3, 12 divided by 4, and 12 divided by 3. In particular, if the child is already showing some degree of fluency with 3 times 4, maybe even 4 times 3, let's leverage that. You know, that might be the next best thing, and especially if you pick some nice easy targets at first, child develops confidence, I can learn this, and then you tackle the harder fact families down the road. Okay? But the key is the small sets. And remember, we're using things that make conceptual sense. Fact families are part of what we're trying to teach, commutative property. These are all, it's not like we're abandoning the conceptual understanding. But we are trying to figure out the right strategies to use at the beginning when you're introducing a new fact that the student doesn't know. You want to do that in a way that ultimately gets you to memory-based retrieval, because that's still the goal, that automaticity. Okay? So once you have introduced the fact, again, I'll show you a concrete example in a second, we start progressively deepening and strengthening the student's ability to recall the new fact. The key thing here is note the absence of the word time pressure. Okay? Here you are just trying to figure out good methods. Once you've introduced something like a fact family and the four facts in it, get the kid to practice those facts. You're trying to get them to retrieve them from memory. Do not bring in time pressure yet. At least we don't. That's the next step. Once they have developed a certain degree of retrieval, your next step is to practice with moderate or modest time pressure. But another key here is increasing difficulty. And again, it has to, like, the more you can make this differentiated and individualized, the better. Because what you're trying to do is make the retrieval harder and harder until it's too hard, and then you're bringing it down. You're always trying to keep them right in the zone, sort of a proximal development. You know, a common sense example outside of math would be when I was showing you the fMRIs, the lead researcher there was Rivera, and the study was done in 2005. Now, I tell you this, and if I ask you again in 10 seconds, my guess is the vast majority of you would be able to tell me who the lead author was and what year the journal article was published in. If I just blithely went on now and then I followed you at the end of the conference and said, hey, by the way, that fMRI study, you know, when was it written and who was the lead author? You might forget. Why? Time has passed. Lots of things have happened in between. So time passage between practice trials is one way to change the difficulty. We don't have the luxury of waiting 2 days before we ask an item again in the classroom, though. So more importantly, we look at what we do in between. What you're trying to do is basically set up some interference, because the stuff that happens in between affects the difficulty of the next retrieval. So by changing what happens in between, you can make the difficulty go up or down. Again, so some of this really would apply more if you were doing like one-on-one tutoring or maybe with a small group, but even if you're working with something like flashcards, you try to modulate the difficulty. You're always trying to keep it right at that zone. It makes sense, right? That's how you get an efficient practice regimen. And here's the last one. This one's a little bit different. Automation of recall via practice under increasing working memory load. What does that mean? Well, You'll get to see one of our games in a second. And this is different from maybe some of the games that you've been used to when you look at, you know, math fact, fluency, drill, and kill kind of stuff. Because oftentimes that's basically flashcards, but with some kind of, you know, cutesy graphic on top. What's going wrong there? Well, one, the kids don't really care. They're smart. They know that it's basically flashcards with some cutesy graphics, so they don't really try that hard. The other thing is, there's no real game there. There's nothing loading their working memory. If you actually load their working memory while they have to retrieve math facts, that's when you're completing that last mile, and it'll make more sense when I show you a concrete example.